Previously on Gaming Legends. Dr. Cortex seemingly abandoned his ableist employment policies and rehired his dizziness-prone former general. This turned out to simply be a front for his global brainwashing scheme, and he managed to escape by using a jetpack. However, Coco suspected foul play from the start and secretly swapped in a counterfeit crystal, causing a chain reaction that destroyed the Cortex Vortex. The remains fell on an ancient tomb somewhere near Adelaide, releasing the naughtiest of dogs upon the universe. So I guess there's only one question left to answer. Can you 100% Crash Bandicoot 3 Warped without spinning? As usual, we'll be playing the Ensane Trilogy version, and the only rule is that we're not allowed to use the spin attack. Cutscenes and victory animations are fine, but anything that both looks like a spin and is within our control is banned. Of course, just beating the game would be nice, but that's not our real goal today. We're aiming for the highest possible completion percentage and the true ending. That means every single crystal, gem, relic, and boss is up for grabs. Let's get started, shall we?
Good luck.
What, you didn't think Crash would go rogue for a third time, did you? Come on, guys, he's a changed mammal. Speaking of changing mammals, Coco is playable right at the start this time. In addition to her almighty powers of telecommunication, we can break boxes by sliding and belly flopping, which are more than enough to get the gem and crystal from Toad Village. Once we have the crystal from a level, we can replay it in time trial mode. Reaching the end within the target time will give us a relic. The fastest form of movement without the speed shoes is hob sliding, which involves sliding, spinning, jumping, and landing before the spin ends. But since we can't spin, we'll instead have to use regular slide jumps or Aku Aku invincibility. Thankfully, we only need to worry about the Sapphire relic times, which are mostly freebies. Under Pressure is our first underwater level, which only gives you two moves, spin and fast kick. Fast kicking makes you swim slightly faster, but it's not legally an attack. In the PS1 version, it is possible to break boxes by fast kicking into them from above at just the right angle. Unfortunately, the colorblind programmer at Vicarious Visions wasn't put on lifeguard duty. Not only does this mean the gem is off limits, but it also severely limits our access to Aku Aku masks and checkpoints. Luckily, the second half of the level gives us a submersible torpedo launcher. We can't take it everywhere, of course, but we can use it to clear out the few crate walls that do block our path. The time trials for the underwater levels are also much harder than usual, since we can't break as many time crates. One of the gems requires you to get at least a gold relic on every level, but here, just getting the sapphire is a close shave, so that probably won't be happening. Next up is Boneyard, which is littered with tall grass that slows you down. Normally, you'd clear out the grass by spinning, but I obviously left my lawnmower at home. Luckily, the grass has no effect on our ability to slide, so outrunning the dino isn't too bad. There is one gem we can't get right now, though, since it requires the red gem from a later level. Orient Express and Macon Waves have you riding Pura and a jet ski, respectively, neither of which are capable of spinning anyway. This easily grants us access to the first boss, Tiny Tiger. Both Tiny himself and his pet lions can be hit with any attack, so this battle is a cakewalk, despite me dying three times. One major difference from prior games is that defeating bosses gives you new abilities, in this case the Super Belly Flop, which increases the Belly Flop's shockwave radius. Moving on to Warp Room 2, G-Wiz and Tomb Time are both extremely easy, though the latter requires the purple gem to get either of its gems. Hang 'em High, meanwhile, is just a little bit mean as it features our old nemesis, Monkey Bars. Just like in Crash 2, you can't slide or belly flop while using them, making any enemies and boxes they hold immortal in a spinless run. In Crash 2, the solution was to damage boost off the floor and jump into the boxes, but such a strategy isn't possible here in the ancient Middle East. In order to damage boost off the floor, you kinda need a floor. The biggest problem is these two crates just before the crystal, which block the entire path. You can destroy them with invincibility in the time trial, but the normal level doesn't have a late enough Aku Aku crate for that. There are two solutions for this. The first is to collect 10 relics to unlock the back door entrance in Warp Room 6, grab the yellow gem, then backtrack to the crystal. The second is to just go behind them. Turns out the colorblind programmer at Vicarious Visions decided to extend the bars ever so slightly further back than in the original game. The only thing we can't get from this level is the box gem, but let's put a pin in that for now. With Hog Ride and Midnight Run both being vehicle levels, we can proceed to fight Dingodile. Speedrunners will usually get over the barriers early with a glitched slide jump, but that requires a spin to execute, so we have to beat him legit. And our rather ironic reward is the double jump, which needs no explanation. On to Warp Room 3! Road Crash and Double Header are both cakewalks, with the former also containing the entrance to the secret level Hot Cocoa. Dynomite just has a few more patches of long grass and Crash's evolutionary ancestors. Look at them. Unable to resist their primal urge to rotate their bodies at a high enough velocity to break a man's neck. Oh, and Baby T is here as well, and we can't even spin while riding him. And since we have the yellow gem, we can not only get both gems, but we can also knock out the secret level Aegipus Rex. Deep Trouble has thoroughly earned its namesake. While there are submersibles at the start and end of the level, the middle must be explored with scuba gear alone. Almost immediately after we're forced to abandon it, we run into an unavoidable shark. This looks like a job for damage boosting and death abuse. As a reminder, dying at least 6 times in the same spot makes you start respawning with masks. But there's one other side effect of death abuse that hasn't become relevant until now. As you keep dying, the game will eventually place more checkpoints along your path. The death counter is tracked independently for each individual checkpoint, which can be either a blessing or a curse. You only need one mask to reach the second sub, though it will take a couple of tight squeezes. Once you get that sub, use it to hit the switch crate at the end of the level, then backtrack and hit the checkpoint. Hitting that switch grants access to a secret path, which requires one additional damage boost to get through. The giant stack of crates looks intimidating, but TNT crates can be triggered from the side underwater. That gives us the red gem, which we can use to get the secret path in Boneyard and meet the original iron checkpoint crate. Which, side note, can you believe got into Nitro Fueled because of a meme?
Yeah, that's right. They laughed. And then they built it.
High Time features more monkey bars, and this time there are boxes completely blocking the path. There is a nearby lab assistant we can use to break them, but only if we spin him. Damage boosting doesn't help us here, and there aren't any Aku Aku crates we can use. And we can't just not do this level because we'll be a crystal short. The only way to get past these crates is... No, I refuse to recycle the same Crash Bash voice clip for a third video in a row. There is one way we can beat this level, but we need to take a major detour. It's time for Operation Time Warp. Before you do anything else, make sure you have all the available relics from Warp Room 3, including Hot Cocoa and Aegipus Rex. Once you've done that, it's time to perform a glitch that I like to call Cocoa Storage. Stand near Coco's laptop as Crash, then do a slide with the R button. If you time it right, Crash should slide away while the Coco menu opens. Selecting No will close the menu, but the game will still keep it open in the background, and it will still respond to your inputs while controlling the character. Swap to Coco to fix the camera, then jump onto the platform leading to Future Tense. Once the platform stops, jump off and then back on, then press Up and A when the screen fades to black. You should now have swapped back to Crash off-screen, which means the glitch is active. You'll need to swap back to Coco now, who has temporarily traded the ability to jump for the ability to clip into walls. Go into this one beside the gate to Warp Room 5, then have Crash jump onto the edge of the bridge. Once you reach the end, swap back to Coco to get inside the Warp Room proper. And in case you're worried about being trapped here, the gate is only locked from the outside. All the levels here are fully playable, letting us get our 15th crystal from level 22, Orange Asphalt. and you might as well grab the relic while you're at it. We do still need all 25 crystals to beat the game, but that 15th one will unlock the Entropy boss fight. I highly recommend making a backup save file at exactly this point. Entropy himself is technically a simple fight, but defeating him gives you the Death Tornado spin. And in a spinless run, this thing isn't just useless, it's an outright hindrance. Future Frenzy has these fans that put you into an automatic tornado spin on contact. Technically, you don't do this with the spin button, and 83% of you seems to think that makes it perfectly legal. But to satisfy the 17% of you that don't, I tried to avoid them anyway. The last one of these is completely unavoidable, seemingly necessitating at least one spin. But remember how I said to get all the Warp Room 3 relics before doing Coco Storage? By combining them with the relics from Warp Rooms 1, 2, 6, and Future Tense, we can get our relic count up to 20. This is enough to unlock level 29, which is actually a backdoor entrance to Future Frenzy. Since we haven't fought Entropy in this timeline, we don't have the Tornado Spin, and that applies to the fans as well. They make you spin once, then reduce your gravity until you either land or do a double jump. This does still leave the initial spin, but if you belly flop into the fan, the spinning animation won't ever get a chance to appear.
And I for one count that as a win. Whoa! What the face reveal is going on here? I'm you from the future, and I'm here to tell you that what you just said about the belly flop is completely false. As you can see from this slow motion playback, when Crash belly flops onto the fan, his model still uses the multiple faces from the spin animation. That initial spin hasn't been erased, he's just doing it lying down.
Oh, okay, well, what about Coco?
Oh, Coco's fine, the spin animation doesn't even play if you belly flop. Just play as her and you'll be fine. What was that? Looks like a Nintendo 64 controller.
Ooh, can I have it? Those things are impossible to buy.
Yeah, sure. You might need it soon anyway.
Thanks, Future Me.
Anytime.
Literally.
The gems in Future Frenzy aren't much harder, save for an extremely tight jump in the bonus round. Once you're finished, you'll be spat out into Warp Room 4. Since the gate is still locked from the outside though, you'll need to do this every time you want to come back here for the foreseeable future. Our next goal for now is to get the remaining crystals from Warp Room 4. Tomb Raider would have been impossible on the PS1 version since the flywheels only react to spins, but the colorblind hero at Vicarious Visions decided to change that. The bonus round has a nitro bridge that you're supposed to clear with the tornado spin, but you can just barely get over it by bouncing off the switch crate. We also get the blue gem from the death route, which unlocks a secret path in Sphinxinator. Speaking of which, Sphinxinator has another alternate path that serves no purpose other than acting as a tornado spin testing ground. But you don't even need to jump, you can just walk along the wall. Bye Bye Blimps is a plane level which... Oh, hang on, something's not right here. That's better. This level might at first seem like it's not impacted by the challenge since it's a vehicle level. However, the vehicle in question is a plane, which can
do a barrel roll.
This move is our only defense against enemy bullets, so we're more likely to die without it.
But isn't the barrel roll triggered with the jump button?
Only in the Insane Trilogy, Cedric. In the PS1 version, it's done with the square button, which is used for spinning. And even if that logic is outdated, take a look at Rings of Power. That is clearly the tornado spin symbol being used as a hint that you need to do a barrel roll. So I'm gonna keep my wings horizontal at all times. Luckily, the plane has an actual health bar and there are chances to heal, so it's not too difficult. With our 20th crystal collected from Tell No Tales, we can finally face off against Engine. The last time we fought him, he altered the function of the spin button. Turns out he decided even that was too spinny and disabled the button altogether for this fight. This means we can easily take him down and claim the ultimate weapon, the Fruit Bazooka. This baby allows us to shoot projectiles while standing on solid ground, and almost nothing is immune to it. More importantly though, we can finally get past those pesky boxes in high time. And because of that, we can get our 21st crystal from level 13 along with the purple gem. It's worth noting that this isn't possible on the PS1 version since the 4x3 aspect ratio prevents you from aiming at the boxes, but here in the land of widescreen, there's no such issues. Now that Warp Room 5 is open for real, there's nothing stopping us from gathering the last 4 crystals. The bonus rounds are all designed around bazooka use, so there aren't many issues. My only real recommendation is to get the green gem from Flaming Passion, which is surprisingly monkey bar free, before Gone Tomorrow to save time on backtracking. The only real challenge is the final battle against Cortex, since you're not allowed to use the bazooka during boss fights. But for once, we're actually able to fight him, since he can be knocked off his hoverboard by jumping on his head and moved around by sliding. With Neocortex thrown down the rubber chute and the speed shoes fastened to our heels, the Crash Bandicoot Warp Spinless Run is officially conquered! But we're not quite done yet. Remember, this is a max percent run, and we've still got a few gems and relics to round up. The monkey bar boxes in Hang'em High were problematic before, but they can all be hit with the bazooka. And most of the other stuff is relative child's play. Keyword most. I briefly mentioned Future Tense's relic earlier, which I originally did before getting the bazooka. The end of the level gets harder as you have to avoid the robots without the ability to kill them, but that is nothing compared to the gems. To even try for the gems, you need to hit this switch crate with the bazooka to unlock this arrow crate. This leads to the death route, but not directly, and the path to get there has more of these auto-spin fans, with some fairly significant gaps between them. Remember, you can only belly flop after a single jump in this game, and only at the apex. Luckily, I was able to get from the TNT onto the crash crate and bounce off it into a belly flop. Once we're in the death route proper, we've got more fans to deal with. For these ones, I did a slide jump into a missile to damage boost upwards. This legally counts as a single jump, recharging my belly flop. Though on one attempt, I ended up landing on the one part of the platform where the fans aren't triggered instead, letting me grab the death route gem easily. However, the gem won't officially count unless we can finish the level. After we finish the death route, we've got to go back through the same fans we did before, but this time without the crates. And try as I might, I've never been able to cross this gap without touching at least one fan in a non-belly flop state. So it seems like both Future Tense gems are 17% impossible. The other 83%, meanwhile, only has one singular crate to worry about, a roulette crate in the bonus round. While you can break it with the bazooka, the splash will cause the TNT to hit the switch too early. Good thing the colorblind programmer at Vicarious Visions was in charge of the slide hitbox. After getting Future Tense's gems and Future Frenzy's relic, it's now technically safe to fight Entropy. But there's a bit of a problem. Because we skipped fighting him earlier, the buttons for High Time and Entropy are now overlapping each other. Stepping on them makes both portals activate simultaneously, with High Time taking priority. But all hope is not lost. If you slide jump off one specific pixel, you can trigger the Entropy portal without activating High Time. Enter the portal as soon as this happens, and make at least 2 backup saves when the fight is over. How fitting that the fight with the Master of Time himself is one of the last things we do in this run. All that remains is Rings of Power, the final plane level. This one is different in that it's a race, requiring you to fly through 30 rings in order. Each ring provides a small speed boost, which is enhanced if you do a barrel roll as you fly through it. As mentioned earlier though, barrel rolls are legally spins, meaning we'll be significantly slower than usual. There's a gem if we win the race, but with how much faster the CPU planes are, don't expect more than a participation award. The real problem though is the time trial. The Sapphire Relic time for this level is 1 minute 30 seconds flat, which is surprisingly strict for our limited moveset. After hours of grinding, my best time is only 1 minute 30.46. So close and yet so far. I gave myself until Christmas Eve to nail this relic, and I sadly failed to meet the deadline. Our final totals for the Crash 3 Spinless Run are 25 crystals, 5 superpowers, 43 gems, 30 relics, and a completion percentage of 103%. The true ending requires a minimum of 100% plus whatever you got from Hot Coco and Aegipus Rex. Since we got both of their gems and both of their relics, we needed 104%. If we got just one more gem or relic, we could do the Cortex rematch and get the true ending. But since the last four gems all blatantly demand spinning in some way, the Rings of Power relic is our last hope. Before I go, shout out to fellow YouTuber Tedeyu, who did this run themselves already, but in Spanish. And special thanks to everyone at the Crash Bandicoot HD speedrunning Discord, who were insanely helpful. I did the run live this time, and you can check out the livestream archives in the description. That's all for now, and I will see you... Ah, for the love of... Hello?
When this is over, we'll see who is obsolete.
What? Who is this? No. No!